Remember the question that we asked, estimate the time. So let me also share my experience. All the fancy videos that you saw for LEDs, LBDs, those 5 minutes took me almost 2 days just to shoot, plan to shoot, and the editing team, based on the amount of animations that were there, it took them anything between 2 days to 2 weeks to completely edit the videos. So that, with all this,
that also requires your timing with them.
Yeah, so I also need to sit with them while doing the entire thing, and for ensuring quality content, I just have to review the entire process. So I have not put the review part over here. So after my review, it goes to another set of reviewers who actually look into content and check for edits and other things. So this is a process flow that we have in IIT Bombay X just for a video. So it is like, you can look at the amount of time that we spend on creating videos.
Yeah, these are, I think, two extreme examples. Some of the videos in FDPs are plain face and slides, that's all. And the other one where you have coordinated efforts of, like, you show this and you show triangle and actual triangle happens. So that is one extreme of the thing. So between the two, you can think of placing yourself anywhere depending on your efforts, time, and resources that you have, most important. That brings us to the session.
There's some another pattern of videos where there is a voice and on a
screen
digital
cut.
White screen, there is writing and again it goes back and forth. Is it part of animation or part of something?
It is called a scribe, where so the technical term for that is called scribing, where you can actually type whatever content you want to tell. And there is a software which will actually have a video scribe.
Video scribe. It's made by Sparkle.
Is it free? Is it available?
Yeah, many such companies have.
It is available, but it has a cost attached to it.
It is a
$69 for a year.
So what it actually does is a very innovative cheating, I call it, because the font will only appear and one hand static image with a pen in hand will just move over according to the strokes of the letters, and it will show as if you are writing. And some non-relevant options, like you can change the hand and the pen and all that, are available there. But yeah, that's what it is. In fact, one of our aim is to have a summer internship project to convert that into open source, because that is required by many people and we don't have open source. We have been, me and Yogendra have been searching for that software for long, but there is no such simple software actually. It doesn't take much. Okay, so we went off for lunch thinking about how many LEDs will we have, in how much time will we have to do one LED and all such things. Now is the time to reflect upon. Yogi gave his side of story and also showed you the ways in which it can be done. Let us just, for our own benefit, try and estimate what would be the effort. So planning a LED, approximate. I'll just count numbers and you just say yes or no. 1 day planning of one LED. 1 day, when we are talking about man days and man hours now onwards. Okay, so we'll, let us not confuse between I will have some other things to do in a day and all that. So one man day for one LED script. Okay, 8 man hours. Now producing an LED with all this what you just saw, and whether you decide to do that, what JK has done, or go otherwise.
Preparation 1 day.
Okay. Yeah, another 8 hours. This is important. Total number of LEDs in your course.
4 weeks.
Okay. 4 weeks, we said, right? How many?
24 to 14.
6 each. 24 videos. Okay. And so total time we can just calculate of 24 into 16. Right. Right. All these things we are only talking about LEDs right now. Right. We have not touched base upon time required for planning your LBDs, LXTs and LXIs. So it's going to be a huge amount of time, 364 man hours just for that 4 weeks of LEDs what we are doing, and all this is in ideal conditions. Okay. Yes, that's what. So we, this is only for LEDs, and we have multiples of this. So imagine around 1,000 hours of work which will take up all these things. Are we okay with this number? Can you think of reducing it? It may only increase but not decrease, right? So that is where the point is, that if this much effort is required, is there a way to reduce this? So one way, like, we can talk to such people and figure out newer ways of reducing the effort. But is there any other way of reducing this effort without deviating from the objective? That is important. We can't say that, okay, we will not do this and that, but how can we, any, yes, okay, like what you saw here, okay. And we didn't have bandwidth to create the content about how to actually record it, so we had one more person coming up last minute. So such collaboration is one definite solution. Then any other option? But collaboration will not make it, like, 1,000 will not get reduced. It will only get reduced for yourself. Each of you have to put in 200, then that will be all, but the total number of effort is not reducing. Anything else? Yes, but they will create their own MOOC. What about your MOOC? And probably they may not thank you for that. All you know.
So total effort remains the same.
Yes, total.
So let's come back to how to reduce the total effort.
Yes, total effort is what is 1,000 hours that we just came up with. And if you are to cover all the objectives what we have decided. Uniform formatting, yes, all this is falling under uniform formatting. Whatever video making, so if we decide to use OBS, we decide to make, like, we use Google Slides for templates, everything, after doing all that, we are coming to this point, right? Okay, let us go ahead and share what can be done. What can be done is repurposing, and there is this principle. Avoid creating new content, instead curate existing open educational resource content that suitable for your learners. Look for OERs wherever possible. Now, wherever possible and curate are the two important points here, because if we don't see wherever possible, it is as good as getting another course and saying, okay, take this. But it is not, because it has to be suitable for your learners. So if you are teaching a course in your university with your own syllabus, there would be certainly some concepts which are common, and there are some new concepts. So the new concepts need to be delivered by you, because only you are the owner of that particular thing. But you can get some concepts from other places which are available in open education resource under the license, and curate them. Now, curate is something important, so we will deliberate on that. Okay, so what is your definition of curation? Can I just get some inputs about that? Have you heard this word in the context of art many times? Right? Exhibitions, right. So what is essentially the task of the curator in an exhibition? It is certainly not just putting them on the walls, right? So, okay. Yeah, more than that maybe. Presenting, yes. So that is presenting as per the our instance, the viewers who are going to, okay. But that is the presentation part. What what is that you select? Yes. So first is to choose appropriate, then present it in that appropriate manner. So that is why first point is identify what will possibly fit to your requirement out of all the things which are available. What is fitting directly with your requirement is the most important point. So identifying that whichever is there, and immediately once you say identify, you have to first worry about whether it is available to you as it is or not. If it is like you have some certain tools but they are costing you money, then you can't, or there are issues about copyright, you definitely can't. So check for the IPR issues and primarily use for OER things so that you don't get into other problems. And then you can, you have identified the content which can be ported. Now once you have selection, then you need to do the next step, which is you can take, this is a common question lot of people ask me, what is this standard YouTube license versus open source. So if you click on that and you go to that website, whatever that hyperlink is, then it will tell you whether it is for viewing or you can use it. Only then you can do that, because most of the other people who are not aware of things simply give an answer that, okay, I found out on Google, therefore I can use it. So that is a biggest misconception.
Okay. One case where we have actually shown you the video of Mandar Banushe, it is in standard YouTube license. So we could actually play it in YouTube, but still we had to get his permission to play it for our course. So you can think of it in that lines. So even if it is standard YouTube license, if you get the permission, you can play it, but it has to be played in YouTube. You cannot put it in embedding also is not actually strictly correct way. Redirect them to YouTube using URL. So as long as it plays in YouTube has the ability, I mean, they have the license to play it whenever they want.
So the implication, the hit gets registered on YouTube.com and not on your site. That is their implication, because they count in terms of number of hits. So if the hit goes somewhere else, they are not happy. If that is their product, it should go to them. That is how it is calculated. And because you have done it and because you saw that some people help you in getting up to that point, definitely try and contribute back to OER so that it can be further repurposed by people who are in the similar boat, right. One of the recommendation is use CC BY-SA. That is one of the best licenses for educational content. For academic use has some relaxations, there are certain things, but now in digital domain, those are slightly blurred and people are still figuring out how to crystallize these kind of relaxations or restrictions. That is what is slightly hazy right now. Some of the video aggregators like TeacherTube, YouTube, Vimeo, OER Commons will give you possible bunches of, these are huge repositories where you can actually search for things. So yeah, so the analogy we wanted to talk to you about this, the repurposing part, is the basic difference between if you want to, if you have a need to write a new textbook versus using different chapters from various books in order to create your course. So whether your course is so critical that you have to write your own textbook finally, it's as comparable as the same. And you know the effort of writing a book, so you will relate to it. Okay. After you get identify, then you have to actually also do the alignment of what is suitable for the flow and the theme what you are trying to use for your own course. So therefore, evaluating the alignment along with the objectives. So constantly compare the objectives of the content you have selected with the objectives you have written for your own course and see what matches or not. It can be in multiple ways. So like I asked him, do you have a video? Then immediately I can think of that as a LXT, because we cannot cover more than this right now. So it is not a LED anymore. Then immediately I can think of that same content as LXT, right? So the content can come in different formats. It depends on how you actually repurpose it. So you can repurpose it in various ways and please put in a thought of how it can be repurposed, whether it is actually a LED or a LBD or a LXT or a LXI. You can use it for creating your quizzes, which is and RCAs, which are we added 3 exclamation marks after that. So, example in the FDP content, we can put in how to record your tabletop videos, which are given by Learn by Watch. So, get Yogendra Pal to sign it up for OER and then put those into this. I don't know if they are already, they are. Yeah, we are coming to the same thing. The specific sections of multiple books, like you have list of books referred for the scores, but there is not the entire book, there are specific sections. So, figuring out which are those sections and accordingly describing them and then using them is very important. Okay, and finally, adapt and remix for your contextual alignment. So, whenever even after you have filtered them for the IPR issues and also the alignment issues, then you have to slightly modify it or at least write a wrapper around it to make it fit into your context, because otherwise it will be just standing alone without any connection. So, this connection is very important, because the learners may not be able to understand why suddenly a new speaker has come up and what is happening. So, you saw that when Professor Sridhar came and gave you the context, why now Yogendra Pal is going to speak about and what. So, this is very important, and only then learners can connect to it. One such interesting example is spoken tutorial, where you can see that the video remains the same and the audio gets changed, and they have explained the process of how you can do it on their website. So, anybody who wants to contribute can actually take down the video and use their process to create audio of various other languages, and that way they have a repository of multiple language screencast tutorials for open source software in over 20 Indian languages, I suppose. That is how they are growing. Yeah, these are extra notes along with the textbook for clarification.
Forum? Netiquette. Great. Any other places where we have repurposed? Khan Academy. Just these two, or? Yeah, so basically whatever we did at the start of today, most of it was repurposing. I just used videos from different places and I just did a voiceover to tell you what this is about. So, essentially we also believe in the, we believe that repurposing is much more convenient and saves a lot of time.
Okay. So, we as we had published in the brochure or the outline of this workshop, so it was about plan, create and conduct, right. But we definitely realized that conducting a MOOC is too early topic to talk about, right. So, we are already looking tired when we thought of 1,000 hours of work to create a MOOC, and I can see that all around. So, obviously, but we just decided to give you some pointers, and that should be helpful. One and the most important, there is no such importance levels, although they look 1, 2, 3, 4, there is nothing about, they are not in priority order. But yes, all of them matter. Publicity, people should know what is this coming up about, and there are multiple channels nowadays for that. Registration, having the teaching assistants for helping you out. The processes for registration also differ, so that could be one of them.
TAs can also be associate faculties in our sense.
Right. So, you have to think innovative ways of getting your teaching assistants. It need not be the conventional definition of a student who has done something. So, that's how I operate. So, all my ex-students get a mail that you want to become a teaching assistant next time, and they do that. Platform features, it's the most critical. What you do on Udemy and what you do on Udacity and edX and IIT BombayX and Swayam differ a lot, and that has to be considered while designing your course. What all affordances the platform is offering may change your strategies. So, don't first put in that unless until you know where it is going, and then you can plan accordingly, actually modify accordingly. Query handling is very important because this is one way of interaction where the learners are not in front of you. So therefore, when they want to know that you have heard and seen their queries is the most important point of interaction, and they want to know all the time. That is what my example has been, my experience has been, and some of you who were learners of MOOCs also will maybe echo the same ideas. Sustaining engagement, because it is not like one off option, especially when you run that MOOC in a self-paced mode for 6 months. It is no way that it is the ending time of a MOOC or something, because for somebody who has taken the MOOC just now and plans to finish in next 1 month, it is the starting time of the MOOC. So such cases will happen, and you have to be ready with that. And finally, using analytics, because for researchers especially who are keen to observe these things, MOOCs give you analytics at a very large numbers. Your data is huge, you get in thousands. So keeping a very nice vigilant eye about what is happening around will help you in generating lot of interesting theories out of it. So using analytics is very, very important, and especially for researchers. So I think that's what we had for the day from our side till the summary starts of the workshop.